I'm Sharon Yarbrough, and I'm a master gardener here at the Extension Center, and I'll be teaching a lesson on daylilies, one day wonders.
All right, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I wanted to introduce to you our speaker for today, who is Sharon Yarbrough, who is the master gardener extraordinaire and the proprietor of Ridgeville Daylilies. She knows them by heart. Also mentioned that we have a number of divisions from Arrowgate that are for sale. The daylilies are $5 each, and the crinums are $10, and all of those divisions came from Arrowgate. And originally, almost every one of those daylilies came from Ridgeville Daylilies. So, what goes around comes around. So, not many are blooming in the garden now, but there's a couple pictures up there of our garden in bloom. The reason they're not blooming this year is because we had a major division year this year. So there, a few are blooming, and a few of those that are on the counter are blooming size too. So, without further ado, Sharon Yarbrough.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
I was in Rhett's last class, so that's been a few years ago. And I guess he saved the best class for last.
Or he
quit when he had us, either way you want to look at it.
Or maybe we did him in.
I know. And I don't know all daylilies. They're over 80,000, and I know a few of them. Anyway, they're one day wonders. One of my favorite things to do with daylilies is a daylily show, and you can see this was at Holly Hill Mall before our club is no longer functioning. At a daylily show, we judge the color, the form, the texture, the substance, and the size of the daylily. We do not judge on whether it was beautiful or fantastic. You know, and the public will walk through and say, I don't know how that got a blue ribbon. That's an ugly daylily, but that's not what we judge. We judge how well you grow it. And I like that because you're only competing with yourself. And some people take it very, very seriously, which is another story. But anyway, in a show, you'll have one junior judge and usually two senior judge. And I like to do accredited shows, although you don't have to be accredited. And this year they call me senior exhibition judge, so that's sort of neat for me to get used to also. And sometimes in a show you win and sometimes you don't. Now the reason I know some of you know Linda, she gets national awards with the African Violets. This is her first daylily show, and her highest ribbon was a red. But the reason I put her on here is that she kept trying year after year, and now she is an instructor. So just never give up. And this was at our show in Fayetteville a couple weeks ago. And this is what the public chose. This is little black buds. A lot of people like that because it's actually got black buds on it. And it did get a purple and a blue ribbon, but it didn't get to the head table. And I'm also a garden judge, and basically we vote on the daylilies that get awards. And one of the things that we do is we evaluate the entire plant, the foliage, the buds, the bloom, how well it grows. So I enjoy doing the garden judging also. Okay, the scientific name for daylilies is Hemera callis. Hemera means day, and callis means beauty. And you probably know that they only bloom for one day. And they came from China and Japan. And these are some of the first colors that came out. And I didn't bring the one that grows in the side dish because it's not one of my favorites at this point. But anyway, the first ones were orange and yellow and kind of a fulvous red. So we've come a long ways in the last few years with those. That's my garden, and I am a national display garden, which means that visitors can come in and look at it. And I'm not going to read all of those colors, but basically there are no really pure white daylilies or any really great blue ones. People are still trying to hybridize for those, but I doubt they'll ever make the blue, but we'll see. Okay, now this is also on the worksheet that I passed out. This is on the back of it. And I put an asterisk by the ones that I would like for you to try to remember. the petals, I think that kind of explains itself where they are. Most daylilies have three petals and they have three sepals. And this, it's not called a stem or a stalk, it's called a scape where the bloom is attached. And you may not be familiar with this one right here, which is a proliferation. And because, I'll turn this off for just a second, and I'm going to show you a proliferation and show you why you need to know about those. If I were going to pop this, I would wait until all the blooms stop blooming, because you don't want to lose your flowers. And then after it gets a little brown right here, I would take my scissors, cut it about a half inch on top at a diagonal, and I'd cut it about a half inch under it and just put it in some potting soil, and it'll grow the same flower. But the bad part is it'll take 2 years for you to see the bloom. And you have to keep it in the shade and you have to keep it watered. Not many daylilies have that, but if you happen to see one, I know Jen Mellon that we've got to sell today has just lots of those. So that might be something that you're interested in. But you've got to keep it moist, you know, until it starts getting a real good bloom on it. As I said, I think everything else kind of explains itself. When the daylily is no longer blooming, the bloom is called a spent bloom. And really good gardeners go out and break those off every day. Because it just looks better. Okay, this is a proliferation that is growing a flower. You don't see that very often, but right down, that's the wrong button. But anyway, all this right here is the proliferation, and you can take that and repot it too, but sometimes they have blossoms in them, and that just happens. Okay, why should you grow them? I think one of the chief reasons that I've got right there is because they're drought resistant. So this 90 and 100 degree weather that we're having, it's not going to bother the daylilies that much. They're easy to grow and they bloom. If you get different varieties, you can get them from early spring until fall. You can have something sort of blooming through the summer. And they make really good cut flowers if you use them the day that you cut them. And they're not that picky about the soil, so they're very hardy and very easy to grow. Okay, if you're transplanting, the best time to do that is in the spring. Well, they can be planted anytime, but if it were like today at 90 degrees, I don't think I would go out and do them in the middle of the day. They have to have 6 hours of sunlight, and this is on the paper that I passed out, so you don't need to take a lot of notes with it. You'll need a raised bed, and they should be well aerated. A lot of people walk in their beds. I always say it's better to walk around them, and then you're not pressing that soil so much, because plants do need a little bit of air to thrive at their best. And you should divide them every 3 to 5 years. Some may grow quicker than that, because I know we've got orange velvet back there. You just about have to do that one every other year, because it's so prolific. And I've got some, I've been growing 10 years and I've never had to do it. It just depends on the variety. Okay, this is Mark out in our daylily garden out front. When we replant that bed, we dig up the entire clump. And that's where all those came from. We just recently did that. Okay, and I think a good way to divide them is to take 2 spading forks and put them back to back, and all you got to do is pull them apart. And we demonstrated this a couple months ago when we had a class in here. And this is the new thing that's come on the market. This is another daylily divider. That's my grandson. And that sells for about $50, so you can decide, do I want to spend that, or can I just pick up a couple of the other forks at a local thing, if that's up to you. But they do work well. And then trim the foliage back to about 7 inches. Okay, and pot your extra fans. If you grow daylilies, you're either going to have to sell some or give some away, because they're going to they're going to multiply a lot. That's some of our master gardeners that some of you may recognize. We're glad to have Connie back this year. Okay, then after you've done all that work, you prepare the soil and the bed. And I really think most of you, just about all of you are women in here. Get your little women's tiller, those little ones, and then you don't have to worry your husband the day after to get your bed fixed. This one probably is a little bit big for us, but if you can handle it, that's a good one to do. But just let your tiller just go and go and go until you get that soil where you can work it. Add organic matter. Of course, there are lots of choices for that.
And I like just for daylilies.
Well, most of your plants would be better off with that.
With what?
With the organic matter.
So
depending on, I mean, if you've got clay or sand or what kind, you know, that type of soil, organic matter always makes your plants grow better.
And that's all it's called, organic matter?
Well, they're different types.
That's what I can give an example that you use for this.
Leaf compost.
You can make your own compost with you know, people have compost things at their house, you can use that, or you can go to somewhere, you know, I don't like to recommend places, but places like Lowe's, you know, they sell organic matter.
Pine bark.
Mm-hmm. That's what I'm saying right here.
Soil conditioner, which is also
Pine vines. But I like to use this in my garden as well as in the pots because I just think it keeps the soil from packing so much. Mm. And it's only like $2 or $3 a bag, so it's a good investment. Right. I know people that will spend $20 on a flower and then they won't do anything to their soil. Mm-hmm. It just doesn't work that way. You got to spend something getting your soil ready. Okay, and about every 3 years, if you don't do this, I think this helps your plants to grow, add lime. And I know there are two types, but I like the kind like Mark is using here, where you just, it's just like a powder. Okay, and for me, I like to put labels on my daylilies. Some people don't care, and that's okay. And I remember the oil man coming to my house and making fun of it, so you know, you go through that too. What are you doing all those labels in your yard? Well, that's just up to you. If you don't like that kind of thing, just don't do it. Put it on a piece of paper. And then I like to replant 2 or 3 fans. You can do one, but sometimes that one will not survive. And I like those little posts there because I don't have to, you know, the wind doesn't blow the label around and they stay where you put them. But there again, if you don't like that look, just don't do that. Okay, tips for transplanting. I think to plant early in the morning or kind of late in the afternoon works better. That's almost with any plant that you do, not just with daylilies. And make the hole larger than the root area. Make a mound and then spread the roots out, and that's on your handout. And the crown should be 1 inch below the soil. Water them very, very well when you plant them. Go on in. Use 1 inch of water weekly and use soaker hoses if you have them. And I think watering in the morning will maybe cut down on any kind of pest that would come. Fertilizing, as I said a while ago, use organic matter. Take a soil test. This is the time of the year that they're free, and all you've got to do is bring us a soil sample here. And use a little bit of fertilizer in the spring if you're not sure what kind of soil you're working with. Maintenance, as I said earlier today, remove the spent blooms. Remove the seed pods unless you're hybridizing. You all know that if you don't, those seed pods are going to go back to the ground or the soil and make different plants, and you really don't want that. Some people say my flower changed colors, but that didn't happen. The seed pod grew another plant. Use a mulch to take care of the weeds and to retain moisture. And at the end of the season, take out those brown scapes. Mm-hmm. Garden design, I think some of y'all might be interested in this. Those are some of the things that you can do to design your garden. That's not one of my talents, so I can't, you know, if you come to me and say, you know, how can I landscape my garden, that's sort of up to you. I have tried doing a daylily bed with all unusual forms, and I found out that I'd rather have just a variety of those. That after a couple of years, I got tired of it. And I do have a friend that only daylilies she likes are the miniatures. That's sort of a personal preference. But you can mix your colors, or you can put pastels together. It's interesting what people come and choose to go in their garden. And you can put, some people like the hot colors and some like the pastels. There again, it's a personal choice. This shows one kind of border. And Bobby Brooks, I don't know her personally, but she does design gardens and takes really great pictures. You can put repetitive colors together. You can put perennials in with your daylilies. There's a perennial border. If you're lucky enough to live on the lake or have a nice pond, that's a good effect. Hot colors together. Similar colors together. Of course, put some art in your garden. That's in my garden, and people do make fun at me, but that's okay. And I don't even drink, so, you know, it took a while me to find the colors.
Actually, those look like those special water bottles.
Now, that's from Iron Gate Gardens in Mebane. But I needed some height in my garden. And this is one of my favorite ways to do daylilies, is just do a variety of perennials with them. And maybe put a bench where you can sit down, but that's one of my favorite effects. Okay, now we're going to talk about forms. Y'all probably already know most of these, but if not, you know, we're going to go over them anyway. This is what you call a double. And I'm not going to read the hybridizers' names today, because I'm not here to promote any certain hybridizer, not even myself. So anyway, this is Some Like It Sassy. This is an unusual form. Let's see, I've even got that one today. This is Skinwalker. And I first saw that one in the year 2000, so that one's been around a good while. Okay, and there are different types of unusual forms. You've got pinched petals, you've got twisted, quilled, cascade, and speculate. Spatulate, excuse me. And I try to remember spatulate because it's like your kitchen spatula. And the cascade, sort of like a, I think I brought Talon today, which has got those twisted, curled up sepals on it. Okay, and a spider, and I actually have that one with me today. And a spider has the width ratio of 4 to 1. That means it's 4 inches this way and 1 inch across. This is Summer Star, which is a really good spider. This one does well in a daylily show. Okay, palmarous means it's got extra petals and extra sepals on it. There are a few that are like that. And every time it blooms, it should bloom like that, not go back to the 6. Single is probably the most popular one. It has 3 petals, 3 sepals, and 6 stamens. Okay, and that's a multiform, which is a spider and a double together. And that would be like this one that wants to be stuck today. That's a spider and a double together. That's something crab legs. And that's one of my favorites. Not that I should say I've got a favorite, but I do like spiders and doubles combined. There aren't many of them in commerce at this point. Okay, and there are other forms. I was trying to think what we've got at the back today. I think we've got stars back there. But anyway, there are a lot of different forms other than just the basic ones. Okay, the bloom size, miniature, small, large, and extra large. And I do like to look at extra large flowers because I think it's I had one in here, but my husband broke it, so I just left it at home. So if you go and purchase daylilies and you say, I want something, you really should have an idea of what size bloom you want, not just, oh, give me a pretty red one, because that doesn't mean a whole lot to people that work with it. Descriptions. And I do know some people that don't like the mid-ribs. Polychromes, I think, are interesting. That means it's got a lot of different colors in it. Let's see, I think I brought a bitone today. Oh, you're looking over those. And this is, you know, just simply means it's got two colors in it. Okay, then you need to know your scape height. Do you want something that's low? Do you want something that's medium? Or do you want something that's tall? I know somebody brought a tall plant to the daily show that I judged on Saturday, and we didn't know quite what to do with it. And I told them, I said, if we had short judges judging this, they wouldn't even be able to see it. But it just towered above everything in there, and I thought, you know, couldn't you figure out it's a little shorter? But, you know, that's just dope life. Okay, and the foliage can be dormant, evergreen, or semi-evergreen. Some people don't like anything but the dormants because you don't have to worry about any kind of diseases that's going to go away during the winter. And some people like them because they might have a hillside and they want to see something growing on it, and then they can see the green foliage there. So it's just a matter of what you like. And the foliage can be blue-green to yellow-green or any shade in between. So pay attention to the color. I do think the lighter the color of the foliage, though, the harder it is to grow it. So I kind of watch that. If it's got a really pale green foliage, I usually leave it. Okay, in the bloom time, usually the peak is about the middle of June. This year it's a couple weeks early, so you can't always go by that. It just depends on what Mother Nature sends us. But there's some that are extra early, which would be like mid-March. And then there's some that are very late. I've got a couple that don't bloom until August. So, you know, you need to sort of see that. As I said, if you'll get some of each type, you can have blooms going through the summer. But we're at peak right now in North Carolina. And the blooming habits, some just bloom normal, some bloom at night. I haven't to this day figured out why anybody would want a daylily that blooms at night. The only thing I can figure, maybe a wedding or a dinner or something, but that's not something that I naturally look for. And the bloom can be extended, which means it can go 16 hours, which would be kind of nice. Okay, look for your branching. It can be top branched, it can be well branched, or it can be low branching. And you need to really watch out for the low branching because you don't want them down in the foliage where you can't see them.
Why not?
Why? You just can't see the bloom as well.
Oh, okay, that's what you mean. I thought you meant the stemming, the scape you couldn't see.
To me, if they come way up out of that foliage, I like them better, but that's personal, not something I'm trying to enforce. And this is something you should do when you're selecting a daylily. The bloom should be fabulous. Higher prices do not always mean that you're getting a high-performing daylily. Look for a good bud count and branching. Find out if they're extended bloom. The scape should support the flower. I'm going to show you a flower in a few minutes that's beautiful, but the scape won't hold it up, so that's not good to have that. The scape should come up out of the foliage. The size of the flower and the height of the scape should be in good proportion. You don't want a huge daylily on a little teeny tiny scape. It just doesn't look right. Check to see if the bloom is sun fast. Now that means that, you know, you have to particularly watch the purples and the reds, because if you've got 100 degrees shining on it, you still want it to keep that color. And unfortunately, there are hundreds on the market that are not sunfast. Somebody just hybridized it and they're so tickled with it, and they said, well, I'm gonna put it on the market. And has it won an award, I think is a good thing to ask. And that means that 8 out of 15 regions voted for it. And that's, usually you can find that on the internet if you're interested in knowing whether it's won awards. You may not need to know this, but there are two types of dahlias. You have a diploid and a tetraploid. This is important to you if you choose to be a hybridizer. Other than that, I don't know that it has a lot of meaning to most people. And we vote on one daylily every year to get the Stout Medal. And this is who the Stout Medal is named after. It takes 10 or 11 years before a daylily can be eligible to win that award. It's voted on by garden judges. So unless you're a judge, you've taken classes and been certified, you can't vote on them. And it has to receive the award of merit at least 2 years previously. And only one daylily can win this award. So we've had a couple people in North and South Carolina to win it, but that's very rare. But he's responsible, I guess, for the daylilies that we have today. And he worked in New York, if you needed to know that. And this might show how daylilies have changed from 1953 up until 2003. Some people cannot stand the orange daylily, and I was telling Chris just earlier today, there's some oranges that I really like. And I think I brought Primal Screen with me, because a clump of this at a distance just stops you in your tracks. That's Primal Screen. And that has not had extra water, so even with that, the blossom gets much, much larger than that. And this one last year, Rose F. Kennedy. I don't know how well it grows. I don't know anything about it. I do think it's a pretty daylily. This one won in 19, well, I don't know the year it won, but anyway, Lavender Blue Baby did win a Stout. This is about as close to blue as I think we'll ever get.
Yeah.
Mount Hermon Treasure.
That's beautiful.
Starfish Cafe. I've had this one to rebloom about 4 times in a season, so it's a good one because of that. 4 different, I mean, completely goes out of the bloom season and then, you know, blooms 4 times, which is most of the summer. Velvet Ribbons. Cotton Candy. Cliffs of a Beak. Orange Grove. Just trying to show you some of the colors and patterns. Great Blue Heron. Revolution. Fancy Face. Watermelon Martini. America's Most Wanted. Art Scene. Apple Swirl, Robert Ethan, that's the first one that I registered. Mm-hmm. Cherryville, anything by Santa Lucia is a good daylily. Mm-hmm. Funky Blue, that's just different. North Wind Dancer, Laughing Giraffe, Tropicana Treat, Dragonfly Dawn, Adorable Tiger, Ruby C. Manny.
You should have that one.
Gorgeous.
Dances with Giraffes. Yeah, this one towers above everything in the garden. And I do hope, I said I wasn't going to promote it, but I do hope one day she wins a Stout.
That is a beautiful bone.
She does some great, great plants. Open my eyes. Manaskasie Summer Mist. Unfortunately, this one died for me. Ooh, I hope she doesn't see this. Drunken Sailor. Ginger Swallowtails. Green Swamp Gas. And I found out I was on phone duty just a few days ago, and we were reading about Green Swamp. That's a good place to visit. That's where the fly traps grow in North Carolina. So I said, that's a good trip. Forsyth, Pink Flying Dragon. Some of you may know Lefevre since he's from right up the road. Gnarly Gnome. Igor. Ann Elwell. Alien Invader, Wild and Wonderful, Mean Green, and I had that one, but that got broken this morning. Late to the Party. If you like midribs, that's a good one. And this is one I was going to show you that's just a seedling because the scape does not hold up the blossom, and I think it's a beautiful daylily. And that's a seedling. Look here, Mary. This one is a seedling. Cow jumped over the moon times Scandinavia. And the hybridizer asked me just a few weeks ago, she said, what would you name that? And I said, Scandinavian cow. But I have an idea she won't use that. I think it's just a gorgeous day, Lily. Okay, and Sears Tower, I've got this one in here because I think it gets like 63 inches tall.
Whoa.
And that's taller than I am.
Wow.
Sebastian the Crab, that's the one I was showing you right here. Happy Apache, that's got an interesting edge on it. That's from a daily show, that was from a show. Lavender Handlebars, that's a different form.
Yeah.
Space Ghost Seashells, there are a lot of patterns in daylilies. That's one I saw in a show and somebody was late bringing it in. You know, if they say the show not to bring anything after 10 o'clock and you bring it in after that, you don't get to judge it. So that was something that got late. And I think it's a pretty daylily. Boogie My Woogie Baby. I like the perennials that's planted with. Uh-huh. Some of you may know Linda Greason, that's in her garden. That's another seedling. And I'm not going to talk a lot about hybridizing, but it's a really simple thing to do. Just collect your stamens and put it on the pistil. That's all you do. And write down what you did. But I know somebody that does, you know, every hybridizer has different things that they do, and that's just one I thought was kind of a neat way to keep up with what you were doing.
Do that?
Oh yeah, I've got, those are my introductions right there. I've done 9. And I did have somebody email me yesterday and tell me how pretty Teresa Moran was, and he had grown it so much better than I did. But that's okay. Anyway, as I said earlier, if you're hybridizing, make sure that you're crossing dips with dips and tets with tets. Everything you cross is not going to make a seed. It's sort of like with people. The seedlings will not be like the parents. That's one of the neat things about hybridizing. Because, you know, that just doesn't happen. There are thousands of plants that can come from your crossing. And some daylilies are just simply not fertile. They just don't have the pollen. Or they might not have the pistil. Okay, if you do hybridize your seed pod, this is a tetraploid, will look like that, and then about 45 days it will turn brown and then the seeds pop out. And that's what the seeds should look like. They should be plump and they should be glossy black. If they are any other color, any other form other than that, you're just wasting your time. And you can plant them directly in the ground. This is a hybridizer that even sticks her, what she's crossed, right there with putting her seeds in the ground. I don't have that much luck with it. I prefer to plant mine in little pots. And I also refrigerate them during the wintertime, so everybody, as I said, has their own way. Other ways that you can get daylilies is, of course, divide the rhizomes or proliferations. I've already shown you that. Or you can do tissue culture, which I don't recommend because I think the chemicals that you use with that are dangerous. I just said, let somebody else do that. And I don't always think that the tissue culture always produces a daylily that's true to what it should be. But there are people that do it, and sometimes you have to work on it many, many times, and they do okay with it, but that's something I would never try. Okay, when you're purchasing a daylily, you have to ask yourself, do I have $3 or do I have
$500?
And I was telling somebody just a couple of days ago that I was at an auction some time ago, and this lady, she might be listening on this, I probably should be careful, but she was buying many, many daylilies, and all she was seeing was the blossom, and I thought, you're really sinking a lot of money, and you don't have any idea what you're buying. Except that it's a 2015 introduction. That's not always a good indicator. But look for things like, you know, what does the foliage look like? And if you go and visit that daylily a few times, you can see if it's got vigor. Does the scape support the flower? Has it got good substance? Will it rebloom? Is it sunbathed? Is it a clear, bright color? Will the bloom melt, turn brown, or melt at the edges? But know a little bit about it before you buy it. Of course, with, you know, today all these are good, and it's a good price on them. Okay, look for a good bud count. That may be overdoing it. Okay, as far as pests and diseases, at my house, I don't have a lot of trouble with these. These are things that can happen, but that's not something that I deal with. They pretty much are disease-free for me. Now, if you take daylilies to a show, you might want to work on the thrips because they love to kind of put little bumps on the daylilies. But not a whole lot to worry about. And if you have any problems with any of that, all you got to do is call and somebody here will help you with it. Okay, questions? And there was one question. I was on phone duty a few days ago, and this was a question that was on the log. Why do my daylilies not bloom? And one of the things that I thought about, well, maybe it's not getting enough sunlight, it's too crowded, it's too young, and the soil needs amending, or it's a weak cultivar. There's a lot of cultivars that just simply are not good daylilies. So those are some of the things that I would suggest if you could say, why is it not blooming? Okay, now I'll take any questions any of you have.
Ma'am?
Yes, sir.
It's not a flower, not. I got a little garden I'm experimenting with, and how should you pluck the bell peppers on a certain size when they get big? Bell peppers and I got some folk coming up. My German Johnson tomatoes, they don't do too good, but my better boys did. They don't do them. But you talking about flower green?
I'm doing flowers at my house. I've got a vegetable garden, but I don't put my vegetables and my flowers in the same place. So. Mark usually teaches a wonderful class on vegetables, so one of my recommendations would be, you know, to try to come when he's teaching the class, because he can tell you from the soil up to when you're getting the vegetables. But you have to pay attention to your soil and how much fertilizer you put on it and how much water.
I got a question.
Yes.
When these fall off and then there's the seed pods left on, do you leave those on?
Okay, are you wanting to hybridize, or you just
want them? I just want them to reproduce.
I would take them and take them off. I have planted enough of those to know that it's not worth your time. It may give you something that looks similar to the parent, but unless you have planned what you've crossed and know a little bit about it, because it could be self-pollinated, which I don't think is very good, I would probably get rid of it. But I always go by and break all of those off, you know, if you see them.
So then they would multiply from the bulb?
From the rhizome, yes.
Rhizome.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
I have a question. Does too much water hurt the daylilies? I know I've had the same daylilies around my deck for several years, and this spring, with all the rain we had, right after they came, they looked really good right after they came up, and then the leaves all started turning brown. Mm-hmm. And I checked to see how wet they were, and the ground was really, really wet.
That's too wet.
Don't,
they don't like to get their feet wet. They like water, but they're not bog plants. They're drought plants, so they would rather be drier than that.
Okay, so I guess what I need to do is take them up and maybe make a raised bed, and before I plant, I'm planning on taking them all up this fall and
that would help.
Dividing them, and I might make a raised bed and put in, when I planted them, I didn't know about, in the soil, well, I think I may have some clay there.
Okay, I've got daylilies around my house, and I went and got blocks that are, you know, that you can get at Lowe's, and I, you know, built up that bed and went all the way around with it. And I, and I also, I use pine needles at my house because I've always heard that you can get termites and other things if you use the other kind of bark. So some people don't like the pine needles, but then I don't worry about insects getting into my house.
Mm-hmm. That's what I have around them, but I just, and this is the first year that happened, and I'm like, what could it be?
It's just
and
too
then
much
when
water.
I did stick my fingers down in there, it was just really, really wet.
I'd raise that bed and maybe put some compost in it too, and put a good mulch on top. Okay, anything else? Yes.
Do you know what kind of lilies they plant along the highways? They are so beautiful.
I can tell you two or three of them. I know that at one time that I checked on that, they use seven different daylilies. Now, they don't put anything really, really beautiful out there, in my opinion, because people would stop and steal them.
Yeah.
But I know Mauna Loa is there and Budded Popcorn. And you probably could find that on the internet if you wanted to know the others.
They
do just mass production, and they're
huge. They're beautiful.
They are.
This year. I wonder if it's because of the we had.
It is. The water did that. Mm-hmm. And they're on those hillsides where they get good drainage.
I have a question. Is the Stella Doro a daylily?
It's a daylily. It's an ever-blooming daylily.
Mine aren't.
Well, I'm going to tell you that a hybridizer told me one time they don't do well in North Carolina because it's too hot here.
Oh.
So, but they're registered as that, and they're supposed to do that, but I don't think they always do that.
Okay.
And more people know about Stella than any other daylily. Okay. And I was going to say, I hope if there are artists with us today that you'll paint pictures. And I found this that I went to a gourd class and they were painting daylilies on gourds. So, you know, I don't see very much art with daylilies. And I think, why not? Because they're such pretty perennials. So I encourage you to do more with painting and that type thing. And I'm not going to do crimes today. That's another day. Okay, I'll turn it over to Chris.
Okay. Well, in case you can't grow a white daylily, which doesn't really, it's kind of the holy grail of daylilies, that and blue. But blooming at the same time as the daylilies are the white crinums, so you can get that same effect. They're actually probably a little taller than your average daylily, but they bloom at the same time and they're gorgeous. So there's a picture of them.
They're like that, except they're white.
Yeah, the ones in our garden are white, but they do come in pink and shades of pink and white. Mm-hmm. We have some of those in the garden. Some of them bloom much later.
So the daylilies that we have back here, how do we know which ones bloom early, late?
You have to look it up on the daylily hemorrhagals database.
Sorry, I don't have that information.
I would say most of those are mid-season.
Yeah, they bloom all about the same time. So some start earlier. Like
Millie Slump
starts
early.
And Jen Mellon is later.
Yeah, Jen is late.
Which one is an early one?
Oh. Millie Slump, S-C-H-L-U-M-P-F. Slump. There's a lady named that. I don't know if she's still living or not. That's after somebody.
So is that it for today?
That's it.
Okay. So if anybody, yes. Yes, once established, they'll do very well. All of these plants, when we say drought tolerant, it doesn't mean stick them in the ground and walk away. Usually for the first year, you have to make sure that they stay watered, because otherwise they could poop out on you. But after the first year, they're pretty well established. Perennials. It's different from trees and shrubs, but perennials, you give them a year and they're good.
Now, this is called a lifetime flower, which means it's going to be around after you leave.
Mm-hmm. And the crinums really don't require the division so much. But if you do get inspired to divide them like we did this year, after being in the ground for 7 years, it's a project. So the bulbs are quite large. So when you plant that bulb, give it room, and don't change your mind. Okay? All right, so you want to buy me daylilies? Well, thanks for coming today.
Gardening classes, usually about two per month. So I think Green Thursday's class schedule, all different kinds of gardening topics. So we've done pruning. We'll have a class on vegetable gardening. We'll have a class on birds. We have a rain garden class, drought tolerant plants, fall lawn care. It's quite a long list of gardening classes we provide to the public to give them a better understanding of different gardening topics. All our classes are free, and they're held at 10 o'clock on Thursday morning here in the Ag Building.